Chuck Edwards. I am not Robert Klein, as you know. Rob is with the congregation with our confirmands at St. Peter's in Morro Bay. Since Bishop was not able to be with us last week due to her positive COVID test. You may notice that I will have a handkerchief with me. I may be sniffling. I went on the golf course and have found myself allergic to grass. Not a good condition when you're playing golf. So I used my last positive, my last COVID test, rather, to test negative last night. So rest assured that I won't be Typhoid Mary for us this morning. We are going to try something, because while the cat's away, the mice will play. I'd like to try a responsive singing of the Lord's Prayer. And I promise you've not heard this. So you have to be able to play with me. You gotta have the spirit. It's a beautiful tune. And I just want us to do just a tiny bit now. The choir is going to be your guide. So I will lead the call and you'll provide the response. Are you ready for this? And I'll even cue you. Thank you. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day the food we need, and forgive our sins. As we forgive those who sin against us. You guys are just awesome. Thank you so very much. Thank you. You are doing so well. Well, there we have it. So let us rise for the cross as we join in our opening hymn of praise.
Thank you.
living God. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Pray. O God, the strength of all who put their trust in you, mercifully accept our prayers, and because in our weakness we can do nothing good without you, give us the help of your grace, that in keeping your commandments we may please you both in will and deed. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Please be seated for the reading of Scripture.
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy. Moses said, "See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I am commanding you today, by loving the Lord your God, walking in his ways, and observing his commandments, decrees, and ordinances, then you shall live and become numerous, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and you do not hear, but are led astray to bow down to other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today, in that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying him, holding fast to him, for that means life to you and length of days, so that you may live in the land that the Lord swore to give to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Happy are they who walk in the law. never do any wrong, but always walk in his ways. You lay down your commandments that we should fully keep them.
Happy are they.
A reading from Paul's first letter to the church in Corinth. Brothers and sisters, I could not speak to you as spiritual people, but rather as people of the flesh, as infants in Christ. I fed you with milk, not solid food, for you were not ready for solid food. Even now, you are still not ready, for you are still of the flesh. For as long as there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not of the flesh and behaving according to human inclinations? For when one says, I belong to Paul, and another, I belong to Apollos, are you not merely human? What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you came to believe, as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither the one who plants nor the one who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. The one who plants and the one who waters have a common purpose, and each will receive wages according to the labor of each. For we are God's servants, working together. You are God's field, God's building. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "You have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, 'You shall not murder,' and 'Whoever murders shall be liable to judgment.' But I say to you, if you are angry with your brother or sister, you will be liable to judgment. And if you insult a brother or sister, you will be liable to the council. And if you say, 'You fool,' you will be liable to the hell of fire. So when you are offering your gift at the altar, if you remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First, be reconciled to your brother or sister, and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you are on the way to court with him, or your accuser may hand you over to the judge, and the judge to the guard, and you will be thrown into prison. Truly, I tell you, you will never get out until you've paid the last penny. You have heard it was said, 'You shall not commit adultery.' But I say to you, everyone who looks at a woman with lust has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to be thrown into hell. If your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to lose one of your members than for your whole body to go into hell. It was also said, 'Whoever divorces his wife, let him give her a certificate of divorce.' But I say to you that anyone who divorces his wife, except on the ground of unchastity, causes her to commit adultery. And whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. Again, you have heard that it was said to those of ancient times, 'You shall not swear falsely, but carry out the vows you have made to the Lord.' But I say to you, do not swear at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by the earth, for it is his footstool, or by Jerusalem, for it is the city of the great king. And do not swear by your head, for you cannot make one hair white or black. Let your word be yes or no. Anything more than this comes from the evil one." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Well, talking with Father Rob this week, I jokingly chided him that on multiple occasions he has preached on original blessing, and I was left the following Sunday to preach on our Lord's gospel message, quite different than his little sign he gave everyone, "You are beautiful." And he's done it to me again. Last week he gets to hand out "Your beautiful" stickers, and this week my text is about lustful thoughts equaling adultery. Those of us old enough all remember the Jimmy Carter interview in Playboy magazine. Chop off your arm, pluck out your eye if it causes you to sin. Remarriage equals adultery. And then there's that prohibition against taking an oath to tell the truth. And just to put the icing on the cake, in 10 days I have to give a deposition. And the very first thing that happens is I raise my hand and swear to tell the whole truth and nothing but the truth. Yesterday, I summarized today's passage of scripture to my wife, the last part about don't swear any oaths, not in the name of God, nor heaven, nor earth, nor Jerusalem. She said, it's no wonder people don't like Paul. To which I retorted, the words come from Jesus. Her response, how inconvenient. Thus my sermon title, The Inconvenient Words of Jesus. Let me begin with my deep conflict about today's passage. On the one hand, I'm a canon of the church. The root of canon means a straight reed. I am to uphold the church's teaching with integrity. On the other hand, I was a debater in college, winner of the bronze medal at the national championship, gold medal of impromptu speaking. I was well trained to take the contrary position on any argument or proposition, and within 30 minutes assume the alternative position. It has indelibly made me a contrarian, always ready to advance the alternative position with force. I distrust people who use the Bible to manipulate folks. And I try to own it when my personal beliefs are contrary to what I believe the Bible is teaching in the Gospels. And when preaching positions that are admittedly heterodox, I always attempt to lay out the orthodox position alongside in order to tell the truth on myself. My task as a preacher today is complicated further by my belief that the Episcopal Church, it's going to sound controversial, has largely abandoned our Lord's teaching on today's gospel message regarding marriage and divorce. When I grew up, remarriage in the church after divorce was rare. When I was a young priest, the requirements for marrying a divorced person were significant. In the Diocese of Los Angeles, it required extensive counseling, determination that the engaged person was not the other man or the other woman. There was a 2-year time requirement from separation. A demonstration that the divorced person had sought and offered forgiveness to their former spouse for their actions leading to the marital breakup. If the broken marriage involved children, there was the requirement that adequate provision existed for their well-being. The engaged couple had to sign a letter of intent in the name of God, which sounds awfully contrary to Jesus's invective against oath-taking, affirming their commitment to marriage as a lifelong commitment. All of the above got bundled up into a package and sent off to the bishop, along with a letter signed by the priest requesting permission to perform the marriage. Why? Because we hold marriage to be a sacrament, an outward and visible sign of an inward and spiritual truth. The canons for the marriage of a divorced person are not intended to punish nor shame. Rather, they are intended to help the individual come to a spiritual maturity about marriage and to safeguard the administration of the sacraments. I take marriage very seriously. During my 20 years as rector, I required couples to have 6 months of marriage classes and counseling. It took so much time. Every couple had to prepare a budget and financial plan. They were all awful at it. Each person had to write a spiritual autobiography in which they had to address the following statement from God: I love you. I created you, and you are a blessing. But I need you to work on the following spiritual cutting edge. Dot, dot, dot. They made wills, durable powers of attorneys, which were executed when they signed the parish registry after the ceremony. And I promised each couple that for as long as God gave me days, I would be available to support them in their marriage. And over the years, couples have indeed called me for help over the rough patches. Of the easily more than 100 couples I've married, I only know of one that has been divorced. Here's what's pained me most in my early years. I've shared this with the congregation in the past. The first six brides to be self-reported that they had been raped or sexually abused. Each carried the trauma unshared with their fiancé. It is a story I would hear time and time again. We must address sexual abuse against women, and yes, against men too. Why is marriage so important in the church? Because it signifies to us the spiritual union between Christ and his church. Marriage for us is not primarily a contract between two people. It is a sacrament, an outward and visible sign of an inward and spiritual truth that we will never be separated from the love of God in Christ. Now, frankly, this is a big burden for a couple to take on at any time, but especially in this society, a society that has traded the revelation of sacrament for the sense and notion of utility. We've traded till death do us part for I will be with you until it's more painful for me than leaving. Part of my message at every marriage I celebrate is to admonish the couple never to forget that their marriage is not merely for their private benefit, but it is to be a source of strength, a beacon of light for all married persons. Please know I am not throwing stones and never would at those who've experienced the pain of divorce. But I don't mind throwing a little shadow at the Episcopal Church, the church I grew up in, the church that I love so dearly. Because I think it utterly fails to support the institution of marriage and to support families. And it drives me crazy. They're things that we're really good at. We have our prophetic voice. We got that down. But boy, we do not know our pastoral voice. The debater in me prompts me to note that in Africa, polygamy is normative in many regions, so much so that marriages are referred to as either tribal or traditional marriages, meaning that a man can be married to 2, 3, 4, up to 5 women, or Christian marriage, in which the couple foregoes legally the possibility of the man taking multiple wives. Here are some facts that might surprise you. According to the Census Bureau, here in the United States, from 2009 to 2019, the divorce rate for women fell from 9.7 per thousand to 7.6. That's more than 20% drop. Alas, during the same period, marriages dropped from 19.7 to 16.3. Still, when you compare them one over the other and do the ratios, there's a real drop in the overall rate of married persons who are divorced, become divorced. Now, you might attribute the drop in marriage to the simple reason that people live together now without being married. What used to be called living without benefit of the clergy is now normative. It's kind of today's premarital counseling. But the truth is that those who live together and are not married have a higher breakup rate than those who are married. On an annual basis, the numbers will amaze you. World War I brought the country for the first time to divorce exceeding 1%, and it grew steadily into 1980, our top year, 5.2%. And it's gone down ever since then. And today we're at 2.9 per 1,000, which is less than 1968. We have the lowest divorce rate in this country in over 50 years. Hooray. Hooray for the institution. When discussing the church's seemingly conflict with Jesus' teaching on divorce and remarriage, Fred Borsch, a renowned New Testament scholar, my bishop, and my friend, shared his wisdom. He told me, I believe in marriage. I recognize divorce as a death, as real as any other death. But mostly I believe in resurrection, that God can raise forth new life, hope, and joy for those who have been devastated by a broken marriage. Margaret Mead, perhaps our country's greatest sociologist ever, said that a person should expect to be married 5 times during their life, that this is the healthiest pattern. She said the trick is to be married to the same person 5 times. By which she means to say that marriages evolve, that there is life and death, and it can be within the context of that same marriage and be a beautiful lifetime relationship. For me, Bishop Borsch's notion of divorce in the context of resurrection created a paradigm shift, and with it, he created space for the Holy Spirit to bring more light, more life into the world through the church. Grace triumphs over dogma. It doesn't resolve the tension between our experiences and the tough demands of our Lord to live a disciplined life. And I don't want to water down the challenges of the gospel. The gospel must always be a comfort to the afflicted and an affliction to the comfortable. You are indeed beautiful, just like Father Rob Sticker says, because God created you as such. But that doesn't mean that your life patterns are always pretty and not in need of some serious revision. The ancient threefold spiritual pathway of purgation, illumination, and union still call on us to reflect and throw out the broken branches in the tree of our life, to root out our sinfulness. But overarching all of this, it is paramount to inculcate into our soul that Jesus does not give up on any of us.
and neither must we. Amen. Let us rise together and join in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God of God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again. Accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and his Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray for the church and the world.
Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give us all reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly in the service of others and to your honor and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Bless all whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as he loves us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of our salvation. We pray for Alex and his family, Emma, Sharon and Preston, Susan, James and wife, Abel, the Baker family, Paula, Constance, Angela, Laura, Ryder, Stormy, Tommy, Hillary, Gray, Terry, Louise, Susan, Ann, Dave, Laughlin, Holly, and Joanne. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that they may share it with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. We pray for the repose of soul for Stephen Schmidt, Lieutenant Colonel Harry Brown, Peter, Tyree Nichols, Lori Morissette, Bill Baker, and Sydney Dunton. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And from the bidding book, we pray for Kathleen and Richard, or Kathleen and Richard, for healing, for Linda, healing, for Dr. Jessica Waldron, repose of soul, for Marianne Mantel, repose of soul, Ann Shires, healing, Lydia Marson, I think, Polito, repose of soul. Pray for Paula and all the Baker family. For Elio, I'm sorry, I can't read this, Musignat, repose of soul. For Katie Doherty, we pray for Philip Sisko for healing. And from, no, okay. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Dear Lord, answer our prayers, not as we ask in our ignorance or in our sinfulness, but in your mercy. Give us that which is in accordance with your holy will. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved our people with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Is exchanged.
Good morning. Please be seated for announcements. My name is Steve Jarrett, and I'm vestry on call today. Before I forget, happy Valentine's Day, if I haven't been able to share that with you. So today the piece is particularly important. For those of you who might be new to St. Barnabas, on page 2, there's some notable events. Pancake supper. That's our version of the Mardi Gras celebration here. The Shrove Tuesday Pancake Supper at 5:30, and then the Wednesday services at both noon and at 7 o'clock. And then also, if you look in the bulletin, starting on page 21 and 22, you'll see some activities, some ministry activity that you may be interested in participating in. The Lent services are not quite ready to be announced, but Father Rob assured me that everyone is working on what we're going to do to celebrate Lent. And I thank you. I think that's it. Father, thank you.
Thank you. I had been told that it was announced at 8 o'clock that imposition of ashes on Wednesday will be at noon and 7 p.m. And if I'm wrong and you're here by yourself in the parking lot, you can just thank Ken and Doug. Do we have any birthdays or anniversaries, travelers to share?
Yes, is. Great.
Amen to travelers. Let us then have joined together in the birthday prayer and a prayer for travelers. Gracious God, you made us in your own image. We thank you for life, love, and joy. Send your blessings upon these, your children, who have completed another year. Surround them with your grace. Fill them with your love, and strengthen them to be your servants in the world. This we ask through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O God, our Heavenly Father, whose glory fills the whole creation, and whose presence we find wherever we go, preserve those who travel, surround them with your loving care, protect them from every danger, and bring them in safety to their journey's end. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Oh, holy Jesus, mercy.
Let's give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
God of all power, ruler of the universe, you are worthy of glory and praise.
Glory to you forever and ever.
At your command, all things came to be. The vast expanse of interstellar space, galaxies, suns, the planets in their courses, and this fragile earth, our island home.
By your will they were created and have their being.
From the primal elements, you brought forth the human race and blessed us with memory, reason, and skill. You made us the rulers of creation, but we turned against you and betrayed your trust, and we turned against one another.
Have mercy, Lord, for we are sinners in your sight.
Again and again, you called us to return. Through prophets and sages, you revealed your righteous law. And in the fullness of time, you sent your only Son, born of a woman, to fulfill your law, to open for us the way of freedom and peace.
By his blood he reconciled us. By his wounds we are healed.
And therefore we praise you, joining with the heavenly chorus with prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and with all those in every generation who have looked to you in hope, to proclaim with them your glory in their unending hymn. By water and the Spirit, now bring before you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread, said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, gave thanks, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering now his work of redemption and offering to you this sacrifice of thanksgiving, we celebrate his death and resurrection as we await the day of his coming. Lord God of our fathers and mothers, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God of Sarah, Rebecca, Leah, and Rachel, God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, open our eyes to see your hand at work in the world about us. Deliver us from the presumption of coming to this table for solace only and not for strength, for pardon only and not for renewal. Let the grace of this Holy Communion make us one body, one spirit in Christ, that we may worthily serve the world in his name. Risen Lord, be known
to us in the breaking of the bread.
Accept these prayers and praises, Father, through Jesus Christ, our great high priest, to whom, with you and the Holy Spirit, your church gives honor, glory, and worship from generation to generation. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done.
Thy will be done.
On earth.
On earth.
As it is in heaven.
As it is in heaven.
Give us this day.
Give us this day.
The food we need. And forgive our sins.
And forgive our sins.
As we forgive those.
As we forgive those.
Who sin against us.
Who sin against us.
And lead us not.
And lead us not.
Into temptation.
Into temptation.
But deliver us.
But deliver us.
From evil.
From evil.
For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. For thine is the kingdom and the power. God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart,
through Christ our Lord.
Blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen. Christ, alleluia, alleluia.